Good evening, and welcome to Writers on Writing. We come to you every Sunday and give you, our listening audience, an opportunity to hear writers from the African diaspora talk about their work, their lives, and their craft. We come to you from Medgar Evers College Radio, 91.5 FM. My name is Clarence Reynolds, and I'm pleased to be the guest host of Dr. Brenda Green, Executive Director for the Center for Black Literature and Director of the National Black Writers Conference. And I'm absolutely delighted to have with me in the studio today Naomi Jackson, whose debut novel, The Starred Side of Bird Hill, comes out tomorrow. Welcome, Naomi.
Thank you so much. I'm so happy to be here.
Naomi was born and raised in Brooklyn, and she's also the author of her new book, Starred Side of Bird Hill. She's a graduate of Williams College, and her work has appeared in literary journals and magazines in the United States and abroad. She is the recipient of residencies and fellowships from the University of Pennsylvania's Kelly Writers House, Hedgebrook, Vermont Studio Center, and the Camargo and Point Foundations. Is that correct, Naomi?
Yep.
So welcome and thanks for coming in, and your debut novel comes out tomorrow. Can you tell us a little bit about your book, The Star Side of Bird Hill?
Sure. Well, first I have to say thank you to Medgar Evers for inviting me. I've been a fan of the Center for Black Literature for many years, been to the National Black Writers Conference, and I actually grew up around the corner from Medgar Evers on Montgomery Street. So it's such a pleasure to be here. It feels like a homecoming, and I'm grateful to Medgar Evers and to the Center for Black Literature for supporting my work. So that we got to start there with thanks. So my novel is called The Star Side of Bird Hill. It's a coming-of-age novel set in Barbados. It's about two Brooklyn girls, Phaedra, who's 10 years old, and Dion, who's 16. They get sent home to Barbados for the summer, and they think, oh, we're just going to go hang out with Granny and maybe get up to a little bit of trouble. And what ends up ensuing is quite different from what they imagined. So their mother commits suicide back home in New York, and their father comes to Barbados with some nefarious intentions to return them to the United States. So the book ends with them facing a very different future than they'd anticipated at home in Barbados. So I would say in a general way, it's kind of about Caribbean American kids straddling two cultures and about what happens when you go home and home is different than what you thought it'd be.
Yeah. Now, your parents are from the West Indies, and you grew up in Brooklyn, as you mentioned. Is there any connection between your characters and your own life?
Sure. I mean, I grew up, as I said, in Crown Heights and in Flatbush. My family is from a bunch of places. My dad's family is from Antigua. My stepmother's family is Jamaican, and my mother is from Barbados. When I was growing up in Brooklyn, we used to get sent home for the summers. So sometimes as soon as the last day of school happened in New York, we'd be on a plane down home like the day after. And I'm sure a lot of folks who are listening can relate to this. So we spent a lot of time at home in Antigua and in Barbados. And I also spent one really memorable spring break in Jamaica. So I've had a chance to visit all the places where my parents are from, and that certainly has informed this book. I wouldn't say that me and my sister, I have an older sister, are the characters in this book. Mm-hmm. I grew up with a whole bunch of cousins and friends at home in Antigua and Barbados, and I would say that these characters are really their own people who are separate from me and my family and my friends.
And you're growing up, did you, in your early years, did you enjoy reading?
Oh, yeah.
Was writing something that you thought you would become? A writer was something you thought you'd become?
People always ask me this, and I would say I was definitely a reader before I was a writer. So I was always that kid that you could find anywhere reading and trying to escape my chores by reading. And I think for a long time when I was a kid, I started threatening my family to write about them. So I certainly knew that writing would be a part of my future. But I don't think I really thought it was a possibility for me. There weren't a whole lot of people in my family or my neighborhood who said, oh, yeah, I make my living as a writer full time. Mm-hmm. So that was a really strange concept and something I've only actually been able to do in the last few years.
Right. Now, you said that you mentioned once before when we were talking before the program aired that you come from a family of storytellers.
Oh, yeah.
How did that affect your, how did that have some influence on your writing?
I think in some ways it's unfair that I'm the person who's the author of this novel because I think there should be shared credit between me and certainly all the men and women in my family. The folks in my family are just incredible storytellers. So my mom's a nurse and she comes home with these incredible stories from the hospital. They're very funny and occasionally gross. Both of my grandmothers were really incredible storytellers. I mean, so I say I get it from them. You know, there's that joke about you get it from your mama. Well, I think I definitely got my storytelling ability from them. So all credit is due to them, and all the mistakes I take credit for. Right.
Now, you mentioned that was your background. When did you realize that you were a writer? Was it when you finished this book, or was there a time before that when you realized that I'm going to make a career as a writer, or I am a writer?
Well, I would say the big turning point for me was probably in 2011. So I quit my job at the Rockefeller Brothers Fund. I was a program officer at a foundation and had been working in development, fundraising for nonprofits, and then in grant making, giving money away to nonprofits for many, many years. And so moving on to grad school was a very big step. I left a very comfortable job and a very comfortable life in order to pursue my dreams as a writer. And for a while there, I think I thought I was crazy. And my parents will probably retell this story, but at first they said, are you sure you don't want to defer a year, save up a little money and maybe go next year? And I said, no, I want to strike while the iron's hot and go. So I went to the Iowa Writers Workshop in fall of 2011. So that was about 4 years ago. And I was very determined to finish my first book. But I would say even though I had been writing for a long time, I probably started writing seriously about 12 years ago. It was only when I was in Iowa City in the presence of many other writers and with the sort of imprint of the Iowa Writers Workshop that I really said, okay, now, if I couldn't say it before, I can certainly say it now. Now I'm a writer.
Great. I have a quick question for you, another quick question for you. What do you think makes for a convincing story? What are some of the elements that make for a convincing story, such as character or plot or voice?
Clarence, you asked me this question in the Killens Review and it was the hardest one. So I would say there's so many elements to a good story and probably as many elements as people that you ask this question of. For me, I really work on developing really strong characters. So characters that you believe might be able to get up off the page and walk around and talk to you. So I feel like you should be able to see and hear the characters on the page. I certainly think a compelling storyline and a moving plot is really important. So I want to work with strong characters, with a moving storyline. And then I really want to experience beautiful prose. I mean, what's the point of writing if there's not some beauty in it? I started out as a poet, so I certainly try to incorporate the lessons that I learned from writing poetry into writing fiction.
There have always been strong writers, both male and female, from the Caribbean diaspora. Is there any particular one or ones that you favor or you feel strongly that you strongly gravitate toward?
This is a question that keeps coming up, and I feel like I need to have my list nearby so that I don't miss anyone. There are so many incredible Caribbean writers, and I think right now is a particularly exciting time to be a Caribbean writer. I mean, just last year, we saw the publication of Marlon James, A Brief History of Seven Killings. We saw Tiffany Yannick publish Land of Love and Drowning, which won the Center for Fiction's First Novel Award. We saw Claudia Rankine's Citizen American Lyric, which got, I think, won the National Book Award, among other prizes.
No, it was nominated for the National Book Award.
For the National Book Award. So those are just some of the really incredible bright lights from this past year alone. But there's so many great writers. Jamaica Kincaid, Polly Marshall. I love Edwige Dantzacot, who also grew up in Flatbush, just around the corner from here. So many. Derek Walcott. And I recently was at the Bocas Literary Festival in Trinidad, and I was just astounded by the sheer quantity and quality of the writing coming from the Caribbean. So just when I thought, okay, I think I have a handle on who's writing, I went to Bocas and it blew my mind. There were four writers who were launching their books that day. Lisa Allen Augustini, who I'd read in Caribbean Beat for years, Rhoda Barrett. Sharon Miller launched a short story collection, Andre Bagu. I mean, there's incredible, incredible writers in the Caribbean. Vladimir Lucien won the Bocas Prize for Literature for his poetry collection, Sounding Ground. And the list goes on and on and on, and you guys will have to forgive me for forgetting some names here.
Okay.
But I'm such a fan of Caribbean literature. I grew up on it. I think without some of those core titles like Jamaica Kincaid's Annie John or Breath Eyes Memory, I mean, where would I be as a writer?
Right. What do you think it is about some of the Caribbean writers, about Caribbean writing or Caribbean literature, that's so universal? You know, it's not just that it's something that appeals to Caribbean people. It appeals to everyone worldwide that reads literature.
Well, I saw Chimamanda Adichie and Zadie Smith in conversation at the Schomburg. Mm-hmm. Well, I saw a stream of it. And Chimamanda talks about being kind of a nationalist for Nigeria and really believing that Nigerians are the world's best folks. And I really believe that people from the Caribbean are some of the most incredible storytellers and writers that we have. I think that there's a facility with language, with poetry, an interest in magic and the surreal that really animates our work. I think we're incredibly funny. We know how to tell a joke, and we also know how to use humor to kind of ease up on some of the more difficult things that happen in life. So I just think that we're just seeing the beginning of what's going to happen for Caribbean literature. I am predicting a Caribbean literature takeover in the next few years.
Takeover. Wow.
So you can say you heard it here first.
Well, one of the things that I know that Caribbean literature covers all genres. You know, it's not just strict literature. It's not feminist literature. Some of it's political. And that's what you mean when you're talking about how it may take over in terms of like the broad range of work that comes from Caribbean writers.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I think what's exciting too is at the same time that there are all these fiction writers. I already mentioned one poet, Claudia Rankine, but there are some incredible other poets. Nicole Seeley is one of my favorite poets who's coming up, and I can't wait for her first book to come out. And there are just so many others coming up behind Idrissa Louise, who won the NYFA fellowship last year. I mean, the list goes on and on. So I feel like I'm going to be in very good company as I come up in literature.
Great, great. If you don't mind, would you mind sharing a couple of passages from The Star Side of Bird Hill?
So this passage from The Star Side of Bird Hill begins on page 11. The characters' names that you need to know are Dion Brathwaite, who's 16 years old, and her sister Phaedra, who's 10. So when this piece of the book opens, Phaedra's hit her head and is kind of working this injury for all she can work it for.
Okay.
And Dion's tired of it. Dion hated most things about Barbados, especially the weather. She disliked the cool damp of the mornings, followed by the unforgiving heat and insistent afternoon rains that drowned any hopes of going outside. During the long, wet days when she was forced to keep watch over her sister, Dion felt like one of the sick and shut in from the church bulletin. Maybe this is what growing old was like, she thought. Maybe the world gets smaller and smaller until there's nothing but the walls around you to show you where you end and the rest of the world begins. The weather was just one thing on a long list of gripes that Dion kept in her head and occasionally wrote in the margins of the fashion magazines she'd brought with her from Brooklyn. Chief among her complaints was that there was nothing to do to entertain herself. The days seemed to just drag on and on. She sometimes looked up at the clock thinking an hour must have passed, when in fact it had only been a few minutes. And while she always resented the long list of things she had to do back in Brooklyn, prodding her mother Avril to get up and bathe each day, making sure Phaedra was dressed and her hair decently combed, cooking dinner and packing lunches for herself and her sister, in Barbados she felt like she had been demoted back to childhood, asked to put on a pair of too small shoes by being responsible only for herself. Hyacinth believed that idle hands were the devil's playground, and so she gave the girls chores to do and signed them up for not one, but two sessions of vacation Bible school. Still, Dion felt a restlessness welling up in her. Dion thought Bird Hill was provincial, far too small a stage for a girl like her. There was a flash of excitement when a talent scout for the Miss Teen Barbados pageant came to Bird Hill. For a brief moment, something like joy washed across Dion's face when the other girls pushed her forward, saying that she would surely win. But when the scout heard her accent, the woman, whom Dion later pronounced both too fat and too ugly to be scouting for a beauty pageant, asked whether she was of both Barbadian heritage and Barbadian citizenship, and she'd had to admit that she was in fact an American citizen. Just like that, Dion's dreams of emancipation from the lot of the fatally dull girls in Bird Hill were dashed. I'll stop there.
Thank you so much.
Sure.
We appreciate that. What do you think would be the responsibility of a writer, so to speak? I mean, is it to change a perception of a place, a person? Is it to make a political statement or a social statement? What do you think is one of, or if you have several reasons that some people write?
So I think maybe we'd have to tease out these questions of reasons and responsibilities.
Okay, let's do that.
I'll say that each writer's responsibility primarily should be to getting the story down on the page in the most beautiful and compelling way possible. So that's number one. I think that that's the responsibility that every writer must accept. Beyond that, I would say actually there are no other responsibilities that a writer actually has. There are some we choose, but I wouldn't say that we actually have responsibilities. So that said, I think for myself, I write because I feel like we need more stories of Caribbean American experience, of Caribbean girlhood. Mm-hmm. We need more stories about us. And, you know, there's a campaign afoot. We need diverse books. And I would say we need Caribbean books. Yeah. And even as I'm saying that there's a renaissance in Caribbean letters and literature, I say that we need even more than what's happening right now. And, you know, so I write because I feel like we need to hear stories like this. And in terms of my responsibilities, I think that I work to uncover some of the conversations we don't want to have in Caribbean communities. Some of those are about sexuality, about mental illness, about girlhood, and about opening up sort of the range of expression and experience that we make possible to Caribbean girls. So I think for better or worse, I'm committed to being a truth teller and to opening up conversations that I think we need to have in our community.
What inspires you when you're thinking about writing or while you're writing? Is it music? Is it other literature? Is it what are some of the things?
So much. So the joy of living in New York City is that you can be a cultural omnivore. You can just consume so much. So I was lucky enough to be in France last fall, and I was there for about 2 weeks and became such a rabid film goer. So I started out just going once a week, and then I was going once every few days. And towards the end, I was watching a couple films a day. Mm-hmm. So I certainly enjoy film, and I hope one day to also write film. Visual art certainly inspires me. I have lots of friends who are not just writers, but visual artists. I love music. I mean, I just saw the Esperanza Spalding at Prospect Park a couple weeks ago. There's so much good stuff in New York City, and we're so lucky, especially in the summertime, to be able to experience a lot of it for free.
Yeah, you're right about that. New York is just full of it, especially in the summer. What are some of your passions?
Oh, wow. Beyond writing. I mean, I would say that's writing and reading are one of my number one passions. I'm a big yogi, actually. So now you're outing me in terms of my love for yoga. That's a big passion of mine. So I say between writing and reading and yoga, I keep my life pretty full.
What are you reading now?
I'm not reading anything. That's my big confession of today. So I've been so overwhelmed by promoting my book and also by I think angstiness and anxiousness about my book publication that I actually haven't been able to read much. So I've mostly been reading magazines. I have a subscription to The New Yorker. I read The Killens Review, which featured my interview with Clarence, but also an incredible interview with Titus Kaphar. I think I might have found my next book cover in there.
We gotta let him know that.
Yeah, we have to talk to him about that one. Poets and Writers, I was just reading that. Judy Blume is on the cover, and I'm featured in there with Tiffany Unique talking about my first book. Mm-hmm. So I'm down to magazines right now. I'm not reading any books, to be honest.
Myself. Yeah. I love magazines. Yeah. Is there anything that you like most about the writing process?
I love the joy of a new idea. So this is a terrible thing to love if you're a novelist. Because the new idea comes and then you spend the next 4, 5, 6, 10, 20 years figuring out what comes after. And so what I do like also is short stories as a format, mm-hmm. because it allows me to have the satisfaction of having finished something, because the struggle in the novel is the deep, long middle, mm-hmm. and then the frustrating end. So you don't get to spend very much time in love with new ideas, but that is where my love lies.
Now, you mentioned humor in your stories, and I've read several novels by Caribbean authors, and I do find them very humorous. I mean, find points of humor throughout them. Where do you think that humor comes from? Is it in your... what?
I don't know. It must be in the water. because I know Caribbean people like to laugh more than anyone really that I know. And I think that it's a part of the way that we live. It's the part of the way we tell stories. It's the part of the way we survive the more difficult parts of our lives. So, you know, I've been at funerals where people are making jokes. Like, our folks have a very deep and abiding sense of humor.
Oh, wow. A quick question. Do you want to think about writing? You mentioned you wanted to think about writing some screenplays, film screenplays, or anything else. Like, is there a memoir in your head someplace? Or
I wish the folks who are listening could see my face, because Clarence said memoir and my face looked really crazy. but maybe I feel like I need to live a little bit more before I have a memoir that's worth reading. I tend to think that my life is way less interesting than the life of the characters who I portray on screen or on the page. So I'm working on a new novel. And I'm about 250 pages into it and hoping to return to it when the book promotion piece for Starside kind of winds down. And I'm also working on a screenplay adaptation of a short story of mine called Ladies. It's a love story set at a Jamaican teacher's college in the late 60s. And hoping that more projects, novels, screenplays, nonfiction books come my way.
Okay. Well, thank you so much, Naomi. I really appreciate your taking the time out to come in and talk about your book, The Star Side of Bird Hill, which is published by
Penguin Press.
And it comes out tomorrow. Yeah. Congratulations. And all the best to you. And we're looking forward to the next book. And we'll also see you at the Brooklyn Book Festival.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Clarence. It's been great.
Thank you so much. I'd like to thank Mr. Fitz Richardson, our sound engineer. And I also would like to end by saying, the writer is always reading, the reader is always writing. Empower yourselves as readers and writers. Have a very nice evening. Thank you.
Inspired by a poem written by Langston Hughes. I'm sure most of you have heard of Langston Hughes. And he wrote a poem about rivers. And we call this song, I've Known Rivers.